Hi, this is Bill O'Donnell, and welcome to another show on spirituality. This show is dedicated for those people out there to encourage them to develop their spiritual life. And today in the studio, I'm very fortunate and very happy to have two representatives of the Franciscans, and we're going to talk a little bit about Franciscan spirituality. So I want to introduce first our guests to my far left, Father Juan Montoya and Brother Jerry Grunstein.
Grantner,
thank you, I'm sorry. Both Franciscan friars, and we'll have them explain all that to us in a minute. Welcome, fellows. And I'm particularly excited because this year is the 400th anniversary of Franciscans bringing the gospel to this part of the world. This year, 400 years ago, in 1598, they first sort of crossed the Rio Grande, and needless to say, they're still here and doing quite well. Governments have come and gone, but the Franciscans have been here most of that time, I believe, to minister to the people. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, fair statement.
Okay. For those who don't recognize the look that we're sporting today, the guys I understand that came in wore denim, I think, or more of a blue, but now we're wearing brown at this time. Tell us a little about, first of all, who St. Francis was and how did Franciscans come to be, either of you.
Well, Francis was a rich young man in Assisi, a man that was always generous, and he had lots. He had everything a young man could want. He was very popular, and everybody liked him because he was very generous. And he made friends with his money and all that. But Francis was a man who experienced what we call great conversion. And suddenly the things that seem so important, all the things of this world, and money and things like that, were not all that important. And he discovered Christ. And he discovered that when he kissed those things that were actually repugnant to him, he kissed leper. And when he kissed that leper, he discovered the love of God that was just overwhelming. And he had a burning desire to become like Jesus almost literally. And so he gave up everything so that he could experience the love of God. And eventually Francis experienced what we call the stigmata, or the wounds of Christ. He's one of the very few canonized saints, and I think the only canonized saint in the Roman Church that had all five of the wounds of Jesus Christ on his body, from his side and his hands and his feet. And he lived with that the last 2 years of his life. People overwhelmingly thought of him as a saint all over Europe. And he was canonized a saint the same year that he died, which is extremely unusual. I mean, it's the fastest anybody has ever been canonized a saint. But I love Francis because he loved the poor. He loved creation. He loved animals. He's very famous in our world today, especially in the world of ecology, of caring about animals, about creation, and about caring about the little people. Yet he was always loyal, never judged anybody. The hierarchy was very corrupt in some ways at the time, and yet he always loved the church. He always remained faithful in that sense, never judging anybody, but spoke by example more than by preaching. In fact, he says, we preach by the way we live, and if necessary, we use words, which I think was a powerful statement, you know. And,
that's great. Tell us about Francis today, Brother Jerry. What is it about Francis and the Franciscans that drew you to them?
I think one of the main things about Franciscan spirituality is the emphasis on the human. We're very concerned about the humanity, our own humanity, whether that be in all of its wholeness, body, mind, spirit, it all one. And we also emphasize, you know, the human Christ. And so we emphasize the humanity of Christ, and this is what helps us to reach out to our brothers and sisters in need, and and they also recognize it in us, you know, that, yeah, we've got our faults and failings, but we'll just, you know, lay it out there just and be one with the people. And the people know that we're one with them, see? There's an instant rapport between us. And so it's that type of interaction that's endeared us to the people and down through the ages, and continues today.
Yeah, it's obvious. I mean, came to this country 400 years ago, and we're talking about a man that lived 800 years ago. Is that right?
That's right.
And there's been how many Franciscans throughout history? I mean, people who have been inspired by Francis or by his followers, Franciscans, to become one themselves. Any idea? Do they have any idea how many Franciscans, men and women, that there have been inspired directly to become Franciscans themselves?
In the 800 years, hundreds of thousands.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I think right now we have, counting all the four major branches of men Franciscans, there's over 40,000.
Throughout the world?
Throughout the world. Counting the men and women Franciscans, yeah, there are hundreds of thousands. Uh-huh. And counting the lay Franciscans, Francis started three orders for lay people, yeah, for women religious, with Claire, of course, and then the first order of men Franciscans, which would be in the secular Franciscans, lay Franciscans, yeah, which number in the millions.
And what type of varied ministry do Franciscans typically do? I know in Santa Fe they man the cathedral, which is not typical to serve in that type of position. But what typically do Franciscans doing today?
Well, of course, our ministry is always an option for the poor, and so we try to be with the poor in wherever circumstances they find themselves. That we enter in with them in their life and actually help them to overcome their poverty. But, you know, we learn a lot from the poor too. And but we'll all the marginalized groups. We in New Mexico here we have 19 pueblos.
12 of the 19 pueblos are taken care of by the Franciscans.
12 of the 19 pueblos is taken care of by the Franciscans and the Pueblo Indians, and then we take care of the Hispanic places. We have our own province. We have a mission down in Juarez. We also have a man out in Peru. And we also have missions out on the Navajo Reservation, mm-hmm, which is the largest reservation in the United States.
Okay. Let's do a little of that clearing up, because the Franciscans are divided. They're worldwide, but they're divided up into provinces in different parts of the world. And here, you fellows are members of Our Lady of Guadalupe province, which is practically a brand new province.
It's only since 1985.
Which is new in church
years.
Yeah. And I remember the shift. And so the original Franciscans that were here, or the immediate predecessors, came from Cincinnati?
Yeah, yes, from this province. We're Cincinnati Franciscans, German-Irish province.
Yeah.
And then those before that were the Spaniards.
Right, originally coming. And so, Father Juan, you're a native-born New Mexican.
I was born in Magdalena, New Mexico,
yeah,
and I grew up in Albuquerque.
Yeah. So how did you get exposed to the Franciscan, and what made you decide that this was the life for you, or at least you wanted to go and explore it?
Well, I went to the diocesan seminary in Santa Fe in high school. And they suggested to me that I try the Franciscans because I was more for community life. Mm. And I remember I went to see Father Salvador, who is the rector of the cathedral here right now. Mm-hmm. And at that time, he was quite young. Yeah. And what touched me about him was that Salvador was such a friendly person. And he smiled, and he was just so welcoming, you know, because I went to at least four or five different other communities, and you know, they were all good, but what I remember Holy Family in Albuquerque in those days was just a simple, very poor place. It was a kind of a dumpy church and a dumpy rectory, really, to tell you the truth. But I didn't care about the place or the building. I cared more about, I guess, the personality of this friar that was just so down to earth. And as soon as I saw him and the way he talked to me about the brothers, we just started a brother's school, and oh yeah, and this would be, we'd be very happy to have you. And he seemed like he wanted us, yeah, you know, and that's what I want to be. Yeah. I want to be like him.
And he was a local guy too.
He and
was
he's a local guy. Salvador Aragon is local.
But you know, it seems to me today, society is so fractured,
yeah,
that most people don't have the benefit of intact families or extended families, and And here is a family of men or a family of women that people can come belong to and have some faith in, that this is a good group to be a part of. Do you have some of that experience when you meet young people who are exploring the possibility, looking for more in their life, and they want to know more about you?
People are hungry.
Yeah.
And I think young people want something very seriously. I think they're confused a lot in America because they think that money and things are going to make them happy. But deep down in, I think they want to be cared for. Mm-hmm. And I think that, I think that that's a basic human desire. And I think when they do discover what we have, I think they like it. But sometimes, sadly, they're just never really given the opportunity or never take the time to look at us and to look at this kind of thing, because brotherhood, I think, is part of what we are all striving for in a way. I mean, I think that's a human need, mm-hmm. you know. Yet we think that things are going to satisfy that, but they do for a moment, and then we go looking for something else.
Yeah. You know? How about you, Brother Jerry? Where did you grow up, and how did you get exposed to this?
I grew up in Chicago. And, of course, they've got a Chicago province, but I was interested in coming out and working with the Native American people, and I knew that the Cincinnati province was out here in the Southwest, so I got in touch with them. And I did my initial formation in Cincinnati and went to the Brothers School. I didn't feel a vocation to priesthood. And so they had a special school for brothers, and you can just do about any kind of ministry that that you have. Francis says to whatever talents you have, lay them at the service of the brothers. And so we can just about do any kind of ministry, whatever our talents happen to be. And yes, people are looking for community and a support group, you know, because we're different than the diocesans in that we have one another to lean on and to be with us and to, you know, form intimate relationships that we can talk at a deep level with one another. Mm-hmm. And of course, at the same time, many people are looking for a family-like, you know, thing that you're saying, the core of our family has to be God, you know, and unless there's a deep commitment to the spiritual life and the religious prayer life, it's very hard to persevere, you know, and that would be the core of our family, yeah. You know, it's not just a family. Per se. Yeah.
Let's talk about that a little bit, because I think the average person perhaps sitting home watching this on television doesn't have any religion, don't have any formal training of any kind, haven't been exposed to it, and they'd see you guys walking down the street and they say, who are those guys? You know, what costume party are they going to? May not even really know what a Franciscan is, because they're only relating to their experience. So they'd never have gone to church, they don't even know how to pray. What types of advice would either of you give to those people who are seeing us now, and what's the benefit to pursuing that?
The religious...
Or spiritual life in general.
Spiritual life in general. Well, you know, it's not very hard to you know, anybody's going to start asking questions about what's life all about. You know, is this all there is? You know, going to work every day and getting up and, you know, where's the meaning? Where's the... significance that gives my life value, you know, and that's where the spiritual life points to something that's deep within us that just needs to be brought out, and we all want to be connected to that, you know, to that something larger than ourselves, mm-hmm. that gives us actually our identity, you know, gives us. Actually tells us who we are, because that's where we come from, you know.
I think that sometimes people put themselves down. People like what you're talking about say, well, I'm not a very religious person. And if they would only pay attention to some of the stuff that's inside of them, I believe that God is in everybody. And those people are a lot better than what they sometimes give themselves credit for. and their very desires that are basic desires of needing love, of needing goodness, of needing peace, compassion, all the things that we call religious, those things are there, you know. And I would say you're far more religious than you think you are. And, you know, I think that as when you live in a community, that's part of what community is about, is that, you know, Jerry brings out my spirituality and my goodness inside, and I try to bring out his. And part of the brotherhood is bringing that out of each other. You know, and I've discovered that you have talents that you never even realize. And then the order has helped me to recognize some of the God-given things that are there. But before I was just like that, and I used to say, well, I don't know how to do anything. What am I going to do in this world? You know, and I've discovered things that I never dreamed that I could do, and I'm happy doing those things in the order.
That's great. I know you're a priest now, but you were a brother for many years, and you're a brother. I think this is important, that people who don't have that call to become a priest necessarily, but could benefit or would appreciate the benefits of being part of something more than what they are, to have a spiritually oriented family to help develop that spiritual life. Tell us a bit about what goes on at a school for brothers. How does it help you in your growth of spirituality?
Well, you know, first of all, we come in into the Franciscans as brothers, and our main focus is being Franciscan rather than a priest. So all of us within the order are brothers. This is Brother Juan to me, too. Mm-hmm. But some of the brothers have sacramental ministry. They do sacramental ministry. Therefore, they become a priest. And so the priesthood is a way of doing ministry. And so, but if you're not called to that particular ministry, way of doing sacramental ministry, then there's so many other ways that you can reach out to your brothers and sisters. And it's just who you are, and what talents you have, and we're open to all those ways. Yeah. You don't have to have a specific way.
And you guys develop those talents. Have an undeveloped talent or thing within yourself, for instance, you work with wood. You're an artist with wood. Is that correct?
No, not me. Brother Bart is.
Oh, that's right.
Brother Bart is. He has a very good cabinet maker, and he's been doing furniture for churches, you know, liturgical furniture, and he does beautiful work. And it was his talent, and we developed it. Yeah, we encouraged him to develop that talent.
I think that's fantastic, because if you think about it out there, I used to be a school teacher myself, and I taught high school, and I saw kids coming through, and nobody was encouraging them. You know what I mean? They were just expected to go along and get along, and they were rebelling inside because, wait a minute, nobody's helping me be who I am to develop this talent. And I've seen that you guys and your predecessors have been doing that for centuries, helping to find and develop talent within yourselves and with others. And I think
sometimes
that's fantastic.
Talents that we didn't even know.
Yeah.
And that's a beautiful thing about obedience. Sometimes people look at obedience and say, oh, what a drag that we have to do what we're told. But in my 38 years, I've been asked to do many different things. I was a cook for 20 years. I was a bookbinder for 3 years. I mean, I worked on the Navajo missions. I've been a pastor. I've done all kinds of different things. And things like now in formation, I never would have asked to do any of these jobs. Never would I have asked. And yet when they asked me to do them, at first I thought, no, me and that, or me doing that. But then I did it, and I discovered things, wow, I can do this, and I never even thought I could. And that's a beautiful thing about obedience, is that they're not going to ask you to do something that, you know, they obviously can see you can't do.
Yeah.
They see something in you, and they say, we think this guy can do this. And that's why they ask you to do it. And so they bring out something that maybe you don't even see in yourself at all.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is a beautiful thing about it. People look at the vows as negatives. I see the vows as positive things. To be celibate means that I'm free. I'm freer in some ways, and nothing against marriage, nothing. I mean, there's many times I would love to have a son, I'd love to have a wife, I'd love to have, family, but being celibate, I am so totally, I don't have to worry about taking care. I remember as in the parish, sometimes you'd be threatened because sometimes we'd fight over peace and justice issues, and some people don't like you when you fight for justice, you know. And I didn't have to worry, well, will they do something to my wife or my kids or something like that, you know? I mean, I could go out and speak out for things, you know.
Yeah, and yet at the same time,
all
those other people who need another father, need another brother.
And I could be that to other people.
Yeah. Yeah. So you have countless children that you don't even know.
Right. That's right.
And that feels wonderful when people say, you know, father, brother, you have done so much. Because I had it in both ways, as a brother for all those years, and as a priest, people have said, you know, thank you because you have helped us in this or that, or because you understand us, or whatever it is. And you feel so good to know that you are helping somebody, especially somebody that was down.
That's great. All right, well, listen, I'm also want to develop that point that you guys are involved in formation. So you get to see the young men who are coming in, and you're there to help them form their own spiritual life. Let's talk a little bit about that. What would a young man find or expect if he approached and said, yeah, I'd like to give this a try. I think the Lord's calling me, and I want to give this a try. Tell us about what they would experience.
First of all, our vocation director would be in touch with them and help them to discern in the very first contact whether that they would, you know, that this was what they were called to. We would give them a certain amount of testing, you know, to see where they're at, and then they would come to visit us, and we would get to know them a little better, and they would get to know us. They would get to know, see a little bit of what we do, and then
would they actually get to stay with you and spend time?
They would stay with us maybe for a week.
Oh, great!
And then and we have a formation house right here, 20 miles south of Albuquerque in Las Lunas. And so they, this is a plus for those who are already out in the Southwest or who want to be out in the Southwest, that they can stay, you know, and spend some time out here. And then they would enter in September for 9 months. And then that would be a candidate coming in, and they would get to know us. They would get to know more about Francis, more about Franciscanism, what it means to live in community. We would give them classes on spirituality and Francis and scripture and so forth. They would go out and visit all of our missions and get to know our province and our friars. And so it's a wonderful opportunity, and yet all of this time is no commitment on their part, but just to see, is God calling me or is not God calling me to this? And we help them to do that. We're not there to talk them into being Franciscans. We're helping them to discern in their life what the Spirit is saying in their life. Where should they go? What does God want me to do with my life? And we want to help them to do that.
Well, that sounds great.
And I think that that's the main point. What does God want me to do in this life? And together, and I think that the Spirit works when a team, like we work as a team with each individual. And we try to say, well, what does God want of me? And I can tell you in the 5 years that I've been in this information work, I can't think of anybody that has joined us, including the majority who have left, you know, who have not left as better persons. I think they're just happier people, and they have really sat down and taken some time to say, well, what does God want me to do spiritually in this world? And I know that even those who have left are better Christians, better Catholics, than they were when they entered, you know. And they've discovered more, they know themselves better, you know. And those who have stayed, you know, we're happy and they're happy.
Yeah, that's great.
And so it's no disgrace to come and see.
Yeah. How old do you have to be?
We like for people to be at least 20.
At least 20.
Yeah.
And is there a top end up into their middle age?
About
45, but we make exceptions.
Yeah.
Depending on how healthy and where the person's at.
Yeah. If somebody's seeing this broadcast, how would they contact you or contact someone to make some inquiry?
They would have to get in touch with our vocation directory and Albuquerque. I don't have his number or anything. His name is Father Larry Schreiber.
He's at the Franciscan Provincial House?
He's at the Franciscan Provincial House in Lakeview.
Okay. So that's probably in the phone book where they can call information.
Or Holy Family. He lives at Holy Family and works at Lakeview. Okay.
Our province also has a website. So people, if they have a computer, they can look us up and read all about what our ministry is and something about us and how they can get in touch with the vocation director also.
Or they can call us, either one of us, and we'll direct you to whoever you want to see.
Well, personally, that sounds like a good deal. I mean, instead of thinking, saving your money, where are you going to go on vacation somewhere and spend your money and come back with a tan or something, but to have a chance to grow in your spiritual life and take a look at something like that, I think that's a great opportunity.
When you stop to think, people that go into a beautiful vocation like marriage, that is, I think, a sacred vocation, how many people prepare for 5 years? Nobody knows about anything in absolute terms, even in 5 years.
Yeah.
But what a privilege to be able to go, and at any time during this formation process, you can say, I don't think this is for me. Yeah. Or I think it is for me. Married people don't have that privilege most of the time. I mean, a lot of times they'll complain because they got 6 weeks or 6 months of having to go to pre-Cana things. But I think it's a privilege to be able to have that time to discern what God wants.
Mm-hmm. And then all through our lifestyle, there's built-in times for retreats and prayer and to develop your spiritual life. It's built into our lifestyle, and that's the focus, of course, is our life with God and how we can take that what we receive from that and help other people to know it also in their lives. So it is a beautiful life.
And Franciscans are active and contemplative. And part of our program during the pre-novitiate year is going to the Center for Action and Contemplation in Albuquerque. And the emphasis for us as Franciscans is on the and. We're not neither contemplative or totally active. We are both. And I really stress the both, because you can't do one without the other. No. It's like Jesus had to go to the mountain and pray before he could go out and do the work. Yeah. He had to gas up in order to be able to to do the work. And I think that's true of us.
Yeah. Well, we've run out of time, unfortunately, but Father Juan and Brother Jerry, this has been a treat for me, and I hope for you at home. And so if it has raised any questions, I hope it's answered some, or at least exposed you to the Franciscans. And if your curiosity is perked by it, please seek them. Try and find out what's going on in your life. And if a Franciscan is handy, I'm sure you can find them somewhere. If you look for them, you'll find them. They're all over the Southwest and throughout the world. So it's been a privilege to have you fellows here representing St. Francis and all the Franciscans. And so on behalf of everybody here at Spirituality, I want to thank you for watching. And please get after your own spiritual life and watch for us again next week. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.